Alright, well, for those of you that are here, welcome to Boundary Value Problems and Index Theory. So, I'm Lashi Bandara, for those of you who don't know me. These lectures will be recorded, but as I was just explaining before, the recording is actually happening prior to the course hitting Zoom, so this is allowing us to stay within the legal framework of this data security stuff and whatnot. So none of the participants will appear in the recording. And if you ask me a question, that also will not be recorded into the recording. I'll just repeat it and then answer it. Okay, so let's just start, and I'll start at the beginning because that's a pretty good place to start. So I'm hoping that all of you have seen manifolds and vector bundles, but so I want to start the topic with just discussing manifolds with boundary. Okay, so let me just change to the lecture scene. Okay, here we go. All right. So, manifolds with boundary. So, so the only real technical sort of obstacle here is to have a notion of a smooth differentiable structure, because we're always working in the smooth category. So in order to really formulate a notion of a smooth differentiable structure for in the presence of boundary, let me just first recall a definition. So if we have some arbitrary subset, so this is some arbitrary subset, so I'm not assuming that it's open, then I wanna ask for a function to be smooth, right? So we say that this is smooth. That's to say that for each point in my subset, we have some open set now, UP, of course containing P, with P in UP, and there exists some function, UP, that takes me from UP to RN, such that this is a smooth function, such that f restricted to this UP, I'll just write smooth extension of f restricted to the UP. Okay, so this gives us a notion of smooth. Okay, so what is now the, so let me maybe actually draw a picture just to clarify what we're talking about. So if we have maybe a subset omega, I have some point P here. So what we are asking is that we have some UP, and we want a function f from this UP, right? FUP that agrees with the function f on this set, or restriction of this set. Okay, so with that, let me define now a manifold with boundary. So a smooth n-dimensional manifold with boundary. So we have that M is just a second countable Hausdorff topological space. And now I have a chart condition. So I want that for all P in M, there exists some UP which is an open set, and an injection satisfying one of the following, right? I either want it to map from, I want the injection to be psi of p, so I either want it to map from u of p to rn, or I want it to map from this up to the upper half space. So this is, these are the points such that the last variable is non-negative. And furthermore, I want a compatibility condition. So if I have W, which is some UP intersect UQ, which is non-empty, then I want the composition, so this is just as before, of this psi Q of W, which is a subset of Rn, to psi P of this W, which is also a subset of Rn, to be smooth. Okay, so in the sense that I just talked about before. Okay, so that's the notion of a differentiable structure when we want to talk about manifolds with boundary. Yes? Not really, because I've set up things so that it's sort of like a blackboard. Well, yeah, we can talk about that later. Okay, so now I want to talk about... I want to talk about interior and boundary points, right? So we can say that a point is in the interior of M. So if there exists some chart containing this P, such that, so this is with P in UP, such that psi of P of UP is open in Rn. Okay? And we say that Q is in the boundary. So the boundary is what? So this is when we find a chart such that the psi q of this point q is equal to x1, so this is some point x1 to xn, so this is satisfies xn is equal to 0. Okay, so it seems to be that there's a bit of a lag in, so I'm not sure what's going on there. Okay. All right, so pictures. Okay, so let me move to the next page. All right. So what are we talking about here? So we're talking about some structure which looks like this. The inside piece here is the interior, the boundary is here, so an interior point would be something like this. So this would correspond to an open set in the interior. Well, maybe I'll draw it like that. And what's another color I can use? Okay, green. So this would be a boundary point, and this would be an open set. Okay. Okay, so now this is a map which, you know, well, so this would be psi of P, and this would be psi of Q. Okay, so this is the sort of picture we're thinking of. So is that better? Is that thicker? Okay. So unfortunately, there's a bit of a delay happening when I'm talking about this stuff. So okay. Anyway, moving right along. So some facts. So the interior, this is an n-dimensional manifold in the usual sense. Moreover, the boundary is also, so now this is an n minus one dimensional manifold, again without boundary. And of course, we have that M can be written as the interior of M, disjoint union, the boundary. Okay. Now, let's see. So let me just give a couple of examples here. So it is exactly what. So for, obviously for a manifold without boundary, and here's where it becomes linguistically interesting. So a manifold without boundary is a manifold with boundary, but the boundary is, of course, empty. So if I now take maybe the unit ball in Euclidean space, so centered at 0, radius 1, I take its closure. So this is exactly the points of Rn such that the modulus of Rn, so this is less than or equal to 1. So this is now a manifold with boundary. So what is the boundary? The boundary is precisely just the sphere. And of course, the interior is just the open ball that we started with. Okay. Another interesting example would be a cylinder. So what do I mean by that? So let me take a manifold which is n minus one dimensional without boundary. So now we can consider the cylinder over it which is just the product of the interval with n. So this is now an n manifold with boundary. So what is the boundary? The boundary of M is equal to just 0 cross N, and the interior is omitting this point, of course. Okay, so these are all examples. So these are all examples of manifolds with smooth boundary. Okay, so up to this point, these are all examples. So all examples smooth manifolds with boundary. But I just want to give a non-example. So suppose I take M to be the closure of the unit cube. So, I mean, I can think of this as a space. If I take the interior of the unit cube, it's obvious that this is, of course, a manifold in the usual sense. It's a smooth manifold in the usual sense. But if I take the boundary, so here I'm really thinking about a topological boundary here, right? So as a topological set, if I consider this boundary, then this is not a smooth structure, right? So this is not smooth. Okay, so maybe I'll sneak in a quick picture here. So it's something like this. Okay, so that's all I really want to say about manifolds with boundaries. So the thick and thin of it is that it is really what you think. It agrees with the intuition of what you think would or should be an object which has boundary, right, and smooth. Okay, so I've just formalized it. So at the heart of all the things that we're going to do are going to be vector bundles. So let me just start talking about vector bundles and associated function spaces with these vector bundles. But I just want to really make a point here that I'm not really going to get into things like the structure theory of vector bundles here. I'm really, you know, the idea is that we have a description of vector bundles. Later on in the course, we'll be looking at differential operators on these acting on these vector bundles. But what will be of interest to us are really the analytical aspects. But let me just recall these facts. So I'm going to set my field to be either the complex numbers or the real numbers. Okay, so by capital or bold K, I'll denote the field that we're working with. Oops. So definition. So we want to talk about E being a vector bundle over M, which is a manifold with boundary of K rank. So the rank corresponds to dimension, capital N, right? So the notation we often write is as follows. Okay, so the first thing is that E is a topological space. And there is a continuous surjection so what gives it a vector structure is if I define E of subscript X to be equal to the pullback of a point, this is an n-dimensional K vector space. Okay, so the capital N here need not be the same, and in fact, almost always will not be the same as the dimension of the manifold, right? I just want to really, so that's why I'm denoting this with a capital N. Okay, so the next condition we want, that we need, is some sort of condition of charts, right? So in some sense, a vector bundle is, these are really the system. So in Euclidean analysis, you would see analysis of systems. So this is really, from an analytical point of view, vector bundles are systems in the presence of geometry. So we need some way of trivializing them. So for each point X in M, we ask that there is some open set and smooth maps psi of x that takes me from u x cross kn into the inverse fiber over u x. Okay. So, I can understand why there is maybe a desire to have this scrolling being smooth now. So, okay, so bear with me for a second. Okay, so I want these to satisfy the following, right? So I want this to satisfy the two following conditions. So I'll go on to the next page. I want it firstly that if I take this projection, so this is equal to x, and this is for all v in kn. And the second condition I ask is that v mapping to psi of x, y, v. Sorry, that should not be correct. That should not be right. This should be y. Okay. This is a map from, this is an isomorphism from Kn to this vector space that we alluded to before. So these things, the ux, psi x, these are called, maybe I'll point this out in a different color. So these are called local trivializations. So they're like charts on a bundle. So what's a picture? Let me give you a picture. So I'll draw my manifold as a one-dimensional object here. So I have a point P here, and okay, so my and so above this point here, I have this fiber. There's zero maybe there. And okay, so this is my fiber pi inverse of a point, which is isomorphic to Kn. Okay. And now we also talked about these open sets here. So maybe I have some open set here. So this is a local trivialization, and so what I would have here is then whole chunk So this whole thing would be pi inverse of u. Okay, so that's the way. So this is e, and then it's a bun, oops, and pi is the projection map. Okay. So, some examples. Oops. Sorry, I keep hitting this button in the middle. All right. So, E equals, or set E to be M cross, say, Cn. Okay, so this is now a bundle, which is, so this is, so this has a trivialization, which is all of M, right? I mean, it's fairly easy to write down. So this is globally trivial. And it's complex n-dimensional. So it's rank n, okay? It's complex rank n. Another example, which you would already have seen before, is if we take the tangent bundle or we take the cotangent bundle. Okay, so this is now an n-dimensional. So this is a real n-dimensional. So this is real n-dimensional bundle. So even in the simplest examples, this is not going to be trivial, right? So maybe I'll just leave it as an exercise because it's not so important. So if we take the two sphere and we take the tangent space of the two sphere, This is non-trivial, right? Non-trivial meaning it's not globally trivial, right? So that's a straightforward application of the hairy ball theorem. Okay, if we take tensors, so we take tensors of rank PQ. So this is the tensor bundle of PQ tensors. Well, I'll let you think about the rank. Differential form. So if we take the exterior bundle, which is just the sum of all of the individual forms. So differential forms. So what's the rank of that? I'll let you have a think. So on a manifold with boundary, so we have the normal bundle to the boundary. So what does that mean? So we have a decomposition if we take the, so I should have also said that on a manifold with boundary, well, maybe I'll write that first, right? Let me erase this. So if I take E, which is a bundle over M, then E restricted to the boundary is also now a rank N bundle over, so this is of rank N. Okay, so then if we apply this to so we have a normal bundle over the boundary, and so what is this? So this is just obtained because the tangent bundle of M splits into the tangent bundle of the boundary plus some other part, right? Oops, there's the normal bundle. So of course this is a one dimensional. So this is a one dimensional. So this is rank one. And another very important example is the dual bundle, right? So this is just the disjoint union of the fibers of the dual fibers, right? Where, so this is the vector space that's dual. So this is the dual of the vector space EX. Okay, so just to recall, this is the inverse image over a point from via the projection map. Okay, so now let's think about some function spaces. So I wanted to talk about these vector bundles because we obtained some nice canonical and natural function spaces over these vector bundles. Okay. So, so this is mainly to fix notation more than anything else. So the first thing that we can talk about is the CK map. So we want to talk about, so this is by definition maps from M into E, which are CK. So again, because we have boundary, so maybe I should have formulated the notion, rather than talking about the notion of smooth maps on arbitrary sets, I really should have talked about CK maps. So it's where you replace C infinity there with CK. Okay. So this is a CK map into the bundle, but I want it to satisfy the following, right? I want it to be such that at each point X, I want it to land in the fiber EX. So this is a special class of maps that take me from M into E, which are known as sections, right? So these are CK sections, and by CK I always denote sections of a vector bundle, which are also CK. Okay. So I can now formulate what it means for them to be compactly supported. So these are, oops, these are precisely the CK sections such that the support is compact. Okay, so SPT is my notation for support. So a remark, so in particular, this means that if I take the support of this phi and intersect it with the boundary, this is in general non-empty. Okay. So when I want to now talk about sections that vanish on the boundary, I denote it with a CC. Okay, so these are compactly supported sections such that the support of the phi is contained in the interior. Okay, so i.e. support of phi intersect the boundary is empty. Okay, and when I have the bundle M cross, well, I guess the reals. So what are the So what is the space? So here I'm going to write CK of M to be equal to CK of M cross R, or E. And then, you know, CK CM, CK CCM, etc. So what are these? Well, this really now agrees with functions. Okay, you can check that these definitions are really consistent. Okay, so I should put an image in here somewhere. So let me just maybe sneak it into the corner. So this would be a phi in C infinity CC, whereas so this would be a I'll call it psi. So this would be psi in C infinity C. Okay. So, maybe if everyone is happy with all of that, we can move on to some further structures on vector bundles. So I want to talk about Riemannian and Hermitian structures on vector bundles. So what is this? So I have, so of course, the Riemannian is just in the case that K is R, right? Whereas Hermitian is the case of K equals C. So I'm gonna look at a smooth section that makes, that takes me into symmetric tensors E tensor E. So this is now again a bundle landing in K. Okay, sorry, hang on. That's being not very consistent with my notation. Okay, and I want that H evaluated at X of some vectors UU is positive whenever U is in the fiber over X away from zero. Okay, so this is said to be Hermitian. So this is Hermitian when K equals C, and it's Riemannian when K equals R. So I should really say here that the values taken by this are so H of X UV oops is landing us in K, right? So for such a structure, I want to define the an absolute value. So the absolute value of U at H of X is precisely equal to the square root of H X at U U. And this is for all U in EX. Okay, so again, some examples. So what are some examples here? Let me take E to be the globally trivial bundle M cross CN. And so I can define H of X of UV here just simply to be the dot product, right? Or maybe I can take some I can weight it with some function or even a matrix. So I can take H, just for simplicity, I'll just talk about a function. So if I want to give it some geometry, I can look at psi of x u dot v, where psi is a positive function, real value positive function. Mm-hmm. Sorry, you're right. There should be a conjugation. Yes. Good point. Okay, so I should really have said in the previous definition that the H of X, so the H should really be a conjugate linear map. Okay, so it's really encoded into when I say symmetric, but when I talk about symmetric here, I really mean, you know, for the complex case that you have conjugation. Okay. So if I now have a Riemannian metric, on M, so that's, well, Riemannian metric on TM, so in this special case, we often just say that this is a Riemannian metric on M, right? So that is now a Riemannian metric in this sense. So from such a Riemannian metric, we have an induced metric on T star of M on tensors and differential forms. So if we take such a Riemannian metric again, maybe I'll just write it under the same heading, and then we restrict it to the normal bundle, then this is a metric on the normal bundle, right? Okay, so I won't give any more examples than that. I think you've all seen metrics before and it's all part and parcel. So, okay, so let's move along. So the next topic really is sort of what I want to end today with. I mean, we still have 45 minutes to go, so maybe I can even go a little further. Let's see. What I really want to talk about is measures and integration. So at least the point of view that I will take with this course is that we will set up all of the necessary geometry, and I want to extract away the salient features of these considerations so we can encode it in a functional analytic language, right? And then we can try and bring analysis tools to understand these problems. So, I mean, at the heart of that is going to be the ability to integrate stuff. So to begin with, I want to talk about notions of sets being measurable and of null measure before we actually fix a measure. That sounds a bit strange, but bear with me. So let's first look at a chart on our manifold with boundary chart, okay? So here I can look at the pullback Lebesgue measure, right? So what's the pullback Lebesgue measure I define, so integrating a function that say supported, so f is a function from u to r, which is integrable. So in this setting, I can define the pullback Lebesgue measure. This is defined by simply going into the chart and integrating F. So no mystery there. Okay. So now I'm going to make a definition. So I'm going to say that a subset A of M is measurable if A intersect U is D phi star L measurable for all charts U and psi. Okay? Similarly, I want to say that A in M has null measure, is of null measure, has null measure, if this is zero, again for all charts. So why is this a reasonable thing? I mean, it looks reasonable, but why is it reasonable? So I won't really get into the guts of it, but one can show, for instance, if you fix any... So the first observation is that if you fix any Riemannian structure on a manifold, or manifold with boundary, if you look at the induced measure from this Riemannian metric, and you look at its measurable sets, this will agree independent of the metric, right? So if I have metrics G1 and G2 and I change these metrics, then the sets that are measurable will be invariant. In fact, that's how you could prove that that the first statement here, that this is in fact a sigma algebra, right? This is a measure sigma algebra because it agrees with the measure sigma algebra of sets coming from a fixed reference Riemannian metric, and it's independent of that metric, right? So that's another way you can make sense of it. So at the heart of that is really the fact that if you have a measurable function in Euclidean space, and you set up a positive measurable function that is bounded above and below, and you weight the Lebesgue measure against that, then the measure sets don't change, right? So all of this you can pull down into charts which are compact, which have compact closure, and you can cover by those things, and then you can show that this notion of measurable is independent of the metric. And the same goes for the null measure, right? You can cover by such things, and you can show that the null measure sets are also the same. So I really want to fix these notions in the background, because it sort of seems like a weird thing, but a manifold doesn't just afford us with a differentiable structure. It also affords us with an invariant measure structure. Okay. So that's the first thing I want to say. So the point is that this allows us to talk about almost everywhere and measurable without a fixed reference measure. So in particular, so just to highlight the point, I can talk about, for instance, I can define the measurable sections of a vector bundle, which is just going to be phi m into e, phi of x is in v x, and phi measurable, which means that inside each trivialization, the coefficients are measurable, right? Okay. But leading up to integration, the first problem we face is that we want some notion of, we want to talk about integration being invariant in some appropriate sense under coordinate transforms. So let me just draw this picture. So what do we have? So we have maybe two sets. them V1. And this takes me with some Psi1 into Euclidean space here. And this is my, well, the image. And maybe I have Psi2 here. This is another thing. So this is my V2. And I'm really interested in what happens in the overlap. Okay, so this is as always, so maybe the overlap is here and I have an overlap here. So what do I have? So I have some map F, say, that takes me from Psi2 inverse composed with Psi1 inverse. Sorry, Psi2 composed with Psi1 inverse. So this is going to take me from F equals. Okay, so this is going, so this is, this here is Psi1 of W, and this here is Psi2 of W. So it's going to take me from Psi1 of W to Psi2 of W. Okay, so what do we have? So what we have is we want to understand how this, how integration behaves under this F. So we have that F is a diffeomorphism, right? So F, I'll write it out again. This is now, I mean, now everything is in Rn. So this is a diffeo. Now, let me take some map psi into the reals. With the support of this psi contained in this W. So what is the integral we're looking at? We're looking at the integral of Psi2 of W of, now this is Psi2 inverse of Y, d Lebesgue of Y, say, and so, I mean, here we just have a coordinate transformation formula, right? It's the good old stuff that we know from Euclidean space. So you can assume that, say, I mean, we can also assume that this psi is smooth, whatever we need to assume, measurable is enough. And what do we have here? So this is now going to be Psi1 inverse. So if you calculate this, this is going to be Psi1 inverse at x. And now we have a factor coming in, right? We have a factor coming in, which is the determinant of df, d Lebesgue at x. Oops, I forgot to put an x in here, just to, okay. All right, so the first thing maybe I want to write is I want to point out that this is, so what's this? This is really equal to f of Psi1 of W. Okay, so this, let's think about it geometrically. So if we think about this geometrically, what we have is that this is just d of y1 wedge up to d of yn. Okay, that's that absolute value of that differential form. And here, what we have is d of x1 up to d of xn. Oops. Okay, and what is this really? So F is really encoding a change of coordinates, right? So this object here, so this is just going to be the determinant of the coordinate transform between these coordinates. So this is just a matrix in I and J, right? It's just a matrix in I and J. So what we really want to do is to account for this geometrically. Okay, so this is the first problem. So this is the first concern when we want to do integration. The second concern, so this is concern number one. concern, so I didn't explicitly write it as that, but this is concern number one. So the second thing is we want to, so given some measure mu, we want to appropriately extract out a measure nu on the boundary, right? And we want to do it in a way, we want this to depend in some way on some auxiliary data that we put on the boundary, okay? So we're going to kill two birds with one stone here by geometrizing everything. Geometrizing this setup. Okay, so for that, let's start with the following. So let W be a finite dimensional R vector space. Not a bundle, just a vector space. Okay? So we say, that psi is a density on W if, so if psi is a map, so this is n copies. To R. That's the first thing. And we have a second second condition we want to ask. So if we take any number of vectors, so let me write it out. So for n vectors w1 up to wn, and we want this to be true for all linear transforms. So this is a linear map, and the wi are some vectors in w. Okay, so this is what we want. And now we define this to be I want to consider the set of all possible densities. Okay. So let's just say a couple of things about these densities. Okay, so maybe I'll leave it as an exercise to, so I'll leave it as an exercise because it's just a calculation. So the first thing is, maybe I'll use I. So the first thing is that this is a real vector space. Okay. The second thing I want to write is that if psi 1 and psi 2 are elements of this vector space, and we have a basis for W, we have psi 1 e 1 to e n equals psi 2 e 1 e n. Then we have that psi 1 is equal to psi 2. Okay. Now, if we have some omega, which is an n form, over this vector space W, then if we define, if we define this to be just the absolute value here, so this is a density. Okay, and the last thing, once you have all of that, the last thing that you have is that this object here is one dimensional, and for any fixed n form, this is equal to the span of, for all non-zero for non-zero n-forms. Okay, so I won't get into it because this is just an exercise in linear analysis. Okay, linear algebra actually, not analysis. So now I want to define the density bundle. So this is the first vector bundle. First vector bundle we'll define. Okay, so I'm going to make the definition of M to be the pairs P and Psi, such that Psi is in the, so we already have a definition for this, and we just define it to be so. So what are the trivializations? So if we have a chart, for M, then we define so the projection map is clear. So we define this from, so I'm really defining the charts the opposite way now, right? So I'm defining the trivializations the opposite way, just like on a manifold where you can go between charts and what's the other thing called, coordinate maps, I guess. Here you can, of course, I mean, everything becomes diffeomorphic where it's interesting. So I can just define it in whichever direction I want. So I'm going to define this as following. So now if I take a real number, which is C, and I look at, so I'll explain what this omega P is here. I'm going to define this to be the pair PC, where C is in R, and the omega P is precisely equal to dx1 at P wedge product up to dxn at P. Okay. So I'll leave the following statement as an exercise. So if we have U1, Psi1, U2, Psi2, which are two coordinate charts, charts near X. Let me say with charts with coordinates X and Y respectively, then you will find through a calculation that. So now I'm going to take just I mean, it's a vector space. It's clear on each fiber. So at some point P, what we exactly get is this, and we get the determinant of dyj on dxi, of course, at P, right? So at P, as we would expect. Okay, so we can see now that somehow we've encoded this condition that I talked about, where we want these integrals to be nicely behaved under coordinate transforms. We've encoded that geometrically into a vector bundle structure. Okay, and this is the density bundle. So I'll leave it as an exercise for those that are interested and haven't seen this before to check all of these things. Okay, so let me now move along. So I want to make a remark. Firstly, so the first remark is that you might think, well, why not just do differential forms? Okay, the point is that, I mean, this density bundle and the top level differential forms are equal, but only under the assumption of orientability. Well, not equal, but they can be identified with each other, but only under the assumption of orientability. This works in general, right? In a general context, one gets a density bundle without assuming orientability. Let me just say M cannot be identified with unless M is orientable. Okay? So let me just first, so now suppose I have M and M tilde. I have two manifolds and I have a diffeomorphism between them. Okay, so these are manifolds with boundary, and I have a diffeo, and suppose that I have a mu which is in my second maybe I'll put a mu tilde on that. Okay, so now I would define mu equals f pullback of this mu tilde, which is a smooth section in the density bundle of over M. And how will I define it? I will define it by f pullback mu at P of W1 up to Wn is equal to, mu tilde at f of P, and then I'm going to have the push forward here. Oops. Of these vectors. Okay. And, okay, so that's the first thing. Now, suppose I have, mu tilde of x is equal to, so maybe inside some chart, I have this being equal to some u tilde of x, dx1 wedge up to dxn. So how does this pullback behave? So this pullback, if I pull back this mu tilde and I look at it at some point y, this is exactly going to be equal to u tilde composed with f of y. And now I'm going to have the determinant here of df at y. And I'll have dy1 wedge up to dyn. Okay, so that's really the point. So I'm just really emphasizing what I wrote before. So why am I talking about all of this? So we want a smooth section of the density bundle to induce a measure. So what is the induced measure? So, okay. So suppose I have a measurable function. And for the moment, I'm going to assume that the support of this measurable function is inside U, where U and psi is a chart. Okay. Okay, before I started writing this, I should have actually defined. So we want to talk about integrating with respect to this, but we want to now restrict to a certain kind of density. So let me just define mu in C infinity M into the density bundle. So this is said to be positive. If whenever we have a basis for all bases for TPM, we have that mu at P of this E1 up to EN is positive, right? So maybe we'll denote positive densities by plus of n. Okay, so now let's return back to this integration question. So maybe I'll actually move this to here. So for just the sake of notation, so this is a chart. I'm going to write psi pullback of mu x as equal to mu psi of x dx1 wedge up to dxn. Okay, so this is my induced basis in this chart for the n form. And so now I'm going to define the integral of f inside u with respect to d mu as equal to maybe this is not the right way to write it, but okay, so this is going to be psi of u f composed with psi inverse of x, and I'll have mu of psi at x d Lebesgue x. Okay, so now we can extend this definition to all of m, right? So for general f from M to R, we let C be a cover. Countable cover of M. And e to I want this to be a partition of unity, smooth partition of unity, subordinate to the cover. So then I can define the integral of f with respect to d mu as simply the sum, the integral of this ui of f psi I d mu. Okay, so this we've already defined now, because f of eta i. So f of eta i is supported inside the UI. Okay, so exercise, this is really by construction, exercise verify independence of the choice of cover and partition of unity, and hence the partition of unity. That's one thing I want to say. Another thing I want to really say here is that, now earlier on I said that the notions of measurable coincide. Okay, I said that the notions of measurable, if we have a Riemannian metric, so the quintessential example of this would be taking the determinant of the metric for a Riemannian metric. This would give you a section of the density bundle, the smooth section of the density bundle. So from what I said before, if we have such a Riemannian metric, then this notion of measurable and null measure that we had agree. So here it's again the same, right? So this is the first one, and then d mu measurable and d mu null agree with measurable and null. Okay, so we have all of that. So let me just, so we have 10 minutes left, which is perfect. So I just want to now talk about the induced measure on the boundary. Okay. So for that, let me first make a definition. So remember, so I guess in situations maybe where you've seen boundary value problems or boundary before, you would see that typically you fix a metric and you talk about something like a normal vector. But here we're not fixing a metric. Okay, we really want to talk about measured manifolds. We want to make sense of how, however, despite not having a metric, we always have the splitting that once we have the tangent bundle on the boundary, we always get a bundle, a normal bundle. So we want to somehow formalize that. So I'm going to say that T is transversal to M. So let me say what that means. So this is a smooth vector field that lives on the boundary, taking its value on the full tangent bundle of M, such that first I want that this is non-zero for all X in the boundary, and I want Tx acting on V, so this is what, equal to V acting on Tx, right, for all V in the cotangent space of the boundary. Okay, now I want to, so that's the first thing I want to talk about. So that's the first thing. So the second definition is, I want to say that T is inwards or outwards pointing. So I want to say this. So this means that for all charts at the boundary, if I consider the push forward of this vector, this transversal vector field, and I look at its value at x, then the nth component, I want it to be positive or respectively negative. Okay, so what am I really doing here? So let me just give you a picture. So okay, so what would a transversal vector field look like? Maybe look like this. And let me just, so this is a chart. And if I go to the half space, so this is my chart here now.
It's not really visible, the red.
It's not?
No, maybe.
All right. It's not really visible. So let me try and... Okay. All right. So now I had a yellow vector here. So maybe this is the vector. So this is my T and this is my psi push forward of T. And of course, this is the Xn. Oops, let me do it in green. This is the Xn variable and this is Rn minus 1. Right, this is my upper half space. Okay, so this is inwards pointing now, right? It points to the interior of the manifold. Okay. So now let mu be a section, a positive section of this bundle of the, so for this we define a nu which is a measure of a positive density on the boundary, sorry, by, so nu of x, now we feed in some vectors n minus 1, this is just going to be nu x t of x. Sorry, yes, this is a mu. Okay, so where these are just some vectors in t x of n. Okay, so that's really where I wanted to get up to today, actually. I wanted to just talk about how to induce measures on the boundary, but maybe I'll just leave you with one more thing, just in terms of thinking about how all of this relates to measures. So, you know, ordinarily I would have, in the absence of boundary, I wouldn't have introduce additional geometric structure and talked about the density bundle. I would have just directly talked about a measure on a manifold. I see the manifold is just a topological space and then I have a measure. But of course, here the reason I took this path was for two reasons. Firstly, it's to geometrize integration, but more seriously, it was really to try and show how, given a transversal inwards pointing vector field, how we would induce a measure on the boundary. So suppose instead that we started with a radon measure. So if we start with a radon measure on M, okay, we could ask, well, how does this respond or correspond to a section of the density bundle? But we cannot just look at any radon measures because we have a notion of null sets already. And these null sets might deviate for an arbitrary radon measure. Okay, so we have to assume that d mu null is null in our sense. And I'll also make a measurability assumption, right? D mu measurable, maybe this can be dropped. You can think about it. Is measurable. So let's assume these two things. So inside now a coordinate chart u psi, So this restricts to a radon measure inside this chart, right? I just restrict this measure, and this is now a radon measure inside this chart. So in particular, I can consider the radon nicotine derivative, right? So here I can take the radon nicotine derivative, and I'm going to assume that the radon nicotine derivative is a smooth function. Okay, so this is the so I'm going to assume this is smooth in U, and this is the radon nicotine derivative. Okay, so let me now define mu of x as d mu, the pullback Lebesgue measure, differentiate, and then dx1 wedge up to dxn. So this is actually, so mu is now well defined, and mu is actually a smooth section of this positive density bundle. So maybe I'll just leave it as an exercise to check these things if you're interested. I mean, of course, it's just a side remark. So really, if we didn't have this condition on the agreement of measurable sets and of null sets, then in the radon nicotine derivative, when we reconstruct the measure, we would get an additional term, just like the constant that you get when you do Riemann integration, that really needs to be killed off. So in general, when you're on a measure space, you assume that one measure is absolutely continuous with respect to the other. But since we're dealing with things like charts, the right condition is really to assume that the d mu null sets agree with this coordinate independent notion of null sets that we had right at the start. And of course, just also a side remark is that, I mean, here we've looked at really smooth sections of the density bundle, but you could look at measurable sections of the density bundle, for instance, and you can go through this entire construction and you would still get measures, right? You might have to be a little careful there because you want some sort of lower bound on compact sets. Maybe you want these to be positive uniformly on compact sets or something in order for things to really make sense. But in any case, we're just going to stick to the smooth world. So for us, the measures that we're looking at are induced from smooth sections of the density bundle. Okay, so I'll end it there. My time is up. Thank you for your attention.